Hi, I am Dr. Selvaraj, Professor of Surgery, Malacca Manipal Medical College, Malaysia. Welcome back to my series of surgical teaching videocasts. These are meant mainly for undergraduate medical students doing the surgical clerkship rotation. I promise you will become competent in clinical problem solving and surgical decision making if you are going to watch these videos over and over again. So today in this episode, I am going to talk about one more pediatric surgical problem, the Meckel's diverticulum. So my objective or the learning outcome of this presentation is, after watching this presentation, all of you should be able to understand the embryological origin of Meckel's diverticulum. You should be familiar with its clinical presentation and methods of investigations. And you should be also aware of the different management options. So I am going to talk under the following subheadings: introduction, epidemiology and etiology, history and physicals or clinical features, workup or investigations, differential diagnosis and treatment. So Meckel's diverticulum is actually, it is a true diverticulum arising from the anti-mesenteric border of the distal ileum. True diverticulum means it has all the four layers of the intestine. It is the remnant of the vestigial Vitello-intestinal duct or Omphalo-mesenteric duct or yolk stalk. The rule of twos is often used for Meckel's diverticulum. This is within 2 feet from the ileocecal wall, 2 inches in length. It is occurring in about 2% of the population. It is 2 times more symptomatic in males, symptomatic by 2 years of age, and potentially this diverticulum is containing 2 heterotopic tissues, namely the gastric and the pancreatic tissue. The first known description of Meckel's diverticulum was made in year 1598 by Hildanus. In 1809, the anatomist and physician Johann Friedrich Meckel identified the origin of diverticulum as the vitello-intestinal duct. The heterotopic pancreatic tissue in the diverticulum was identified in 1861 by Jenker, and the gastric mucosa in 1904 by Salzer. The Meckel's diverticulum is the most common vitelline duct abnormality, and it is also the most common congenital anomaly of GI tract. The fetal midgut is attached to the yolk sac via the vitello-intestinal duct. This is also known as the Omphalo-mesenteric duct or yolk sac. So this is the yolk sac, and this is actually attached to the midgut, wide mouth here, but soon it will become very narrow. It get, and finally it will get obliterates around 5 to 8 weeks of intrauterine gestation. The Meckel's diverticulum results from failure of the proximal duct, this VI duct, that failure of the proximal duct to obliterate. So this part, this is the VI duct, this is the yolk sac, and this is the midgut, and this is the vitello-intestinal duct. If this part of the duct is not, if it doesn't obliterate, so then the Meckel's diverticulum will result. The Meckel's diverticulum has been called the great imitator because of its varied manifestation. The commonest presenting problem of a Meckel's diverticulum, it can present in so many ways. The most common is, of course, the bleeding. It can also present with intestinal obstruction, pain because of the inflammation of the Meckel's diverticulum, and umbilical discharge, especially in neonates. So bleeding accounts for more than 50% of all instances of lower GI bleeding in children, usually occurring in infants and toddlers. The bleeding is due to ulcer formation from the acid secreted from the ectopic gastric mucosa, and it can be very severe. Meckel's diverticulum can cause intestinal obstruction by one of the several following mechanisms. It may be because of a Meckel's band. The Meckel's diverticulum can act as a lead point and it can cause intussusception. The Meckel's band can produce volvulus. The internal herniation also sometimes can occur. Sometimes there may be prolapse through the pattern vitello-intestinal. The whole intestine will prolapse through the pattern vitello-intestinal duct. So there will be a mass coming out of the umbilicus. It can also present as pain abdomen, especially if the Meckel's diverticulum is inflamed, that will clinically mimic like acute appendicitis. If it is, if the whole vitello-intestinal duct is patent, the whole duct is patent, then there will be a communication between the umbilicus and the terminal ileum. So this or the terminal part of the ileum. So the fecal matter will come through the umbilicus. This is very common in the neonates. So when complete patency of the VI duct is there, okay, there will be umbilical discharge, and this discharge is actually fecal discharge. So here you are seeing the various types of VI duct anomaly. This is a typical or classical Meckel's diverticulum. It is an outpouching from the anti-mesenteric border, and it has got its own blood supply. You are seeing a separate blood supply to the Meckel's diverticulum. Suppose if the VI duct is completely obliterated, and it can manifest as a complete fibrous cord like this, or the umbilical end may be patent, and that will produce an umbilical sinus, and baby will be present with umbilical adenoma. So these patients, they will be having umbilical discharge, but not fecal discharge. It will be just serosanguinous discharge may come from the umbilicus. Sometime, okay, the this is the Meckel's diverticulum. From the end of the Meckel's diverticulum, there is a band going to the umbilicus. So this band and this band can cause intestinal obstruction. And this is the complete patency of the VI duct. So this is called umbilico-intestinal fistula. So the fecal matter will be coming through the umbilicus. Fecal discharge, this is usually this manifests in neonatal babies. Sometimes only the central part of the VI duct is patent. Both the proximal and the distal part is obliterated. This will form a cyst. So this is a case. This patient abdomen was open thinking this is a case of appendicectomy, but after opening the abdomen, the umbilicus is normal, so they pulled out the proximal, the distal part of the ileum, so they found out inflamed and perforated Meckel's diverticulum. This is the Meckel's diverticulum, but it is already perforated. So how the timing of the various presentation? So if it is bleeding, okay, it is more common in, okay, the new infants and in the children, and also it is common in the adolescent period. The obstruction also common during the infant period, during the childhood, and during the adolescence. Whereas the inflammation, this will start in a little bit elder children, and then it is common in adolescent, and it will go on presenting in the adults also. Whereas the neoplastic changes, this will happen only during the adult period. So what are the workup or what are the investigations you had to do? The diagnosed, the investigation or the gold standard investigation is technetium 99 pertechnate scintigraphy, or this is also known as Meckel scan. This is the investigation of choice. This is nothing but radioisotope scan. It is used to detect the heterotopic gastric mucosa. Pentagastrin, histamine blockers, and glucagon may enhance the accuracy of the diagnosis of this Meckel scan. Apart from the Meckel scan, if the patient is having severe active bleeding, you can also do mesenteric angiography. So here in the first picture, you are seeing a technetium 99 scan or Meckel scan. This is the anterior view and this is the posterior view of the patient. So this concentration dye or the technetium 99 is concentrated in the stomach area. So this is because of the gastric mucosa, and little bit concentration over the bladder area because this dye will get excreted in the urine. So you are seeing a trace of this dye in the urinary bladder also. So apart from that, you will see a concentration in the right iliac fossa also, in the area of terminal ileum. Okay, this is because of the presence of gastric mucosa in the Meckel's diverticulum. That is why this tracer dye or the technetium 99 is concentrating here in this area, right iliac fossa. This is a posterior view. Half an hour after giving this, dye, you had to take this picture with gamma camera. Suppose if the baby is bleeding actively and profusely, then you can also do mesenteric angiogram. Selectively, you can inject the dye and you can see it is going there, and there will be extravasation of the dye from this from the artery supplying the Meckel's diverticulum. So the differential diagnosis are malrotation, acute appendicitis, gastroenteritis, peptic ulcer disease, intestinal duplication, sometimes cow's milk protein intolerance or allergy. All these things you have to keep it in mind in case of Meckel's diverticulum. So coming to the treatment, in incidentally discovered diverticulum, there is no need for surgical excision. However, if there is thickening of diverticulum suggestive of heterotopic mucosa, then elective resection can be done. The bleeding child should be placed nil by mouth and appropriately resuscitated. If the baby is in shock, you have to resuscitate the baby, or if baby is very anemic, you can even give blood transfusion. In symptomatic patients, the diverticulum is removed using a laparoscopic assisted or open technique. The technique comprises either a simple resection of the diverticulum, that is the wedge resection, and transverse closure across the base of the diverticulum, or you can do a resection of a short segment of ileum, that is segmental resection containing the diverticulum. That area also you have to remove, followed by the end-to-end ileal anastomosis. The lateral technique, that is the segmental resection, is recommended in bleeding patients because it deals with any ulcer which may present in the adjoining 5 cm of the distal ileum. The feeding diverticular artery on the surface of the ileum should be clearly identified and ligated in all cases of Meckel's diverticulectomy. So here you are seeing the first picture. They are doing a transverse, okay, this is the wedge resection. You are doing a elliptical incision, transverse incision. You have to excise this one, then you have to close the intestine transversely like this. So Heinke-Michaelis principle, this is how you have to close, because otherwise if you are going to close the intestine longitudinally, you will be compromising the diameter of the bowel. So whenever you are doing, this is a surgical dictum, whenever you are doing intestinal surgery, you have to remove the enterotomy transversely like this, not longitudinally like this. So this is wedge resection, whereas here you are seeing this is the segmental resection. So you have to resect a part of the ileum proximally and distally along with the diverticulum, and then you have to do the end-to-end anastomosis. This is a Meckel's diverticulum. You are seeing some color change inside because of the bleeding inside. So this is the Meckel's diverticulum, and here you are seeing the picture. This is the segmental resection. You have to cut here and cut here. So this part of the thing will come out, and then you have to do the end-to-end anastomosis of the ileum. Suppose if it is a neonate and the baby is having a fecal discharge through the umbilicus, then you have to suspect the complete patency of the whole vitello-intestinal duct. In this case, okay, you have to do a circular incision to mobilize the umbilical end of the VI duct. Then you have to open the abdomen through an infra-umbilical transverse incision. Then you have to find out the connection, the VI duct, and then you have to open the abdomen. You have to make incision in the fascia, open the abdomen, find out the connection. This duct will go and open in the ileum. So this ileum also has to be pulled out, and then you have to resect, do a segmental resection, and then do end-to-end anastomosis. And then, of course, you have to close this umbilical defect also. So thank you very much for watching this video. If you think that these videos are very useful, kindly subscribe to this channel and share these videos in your social media. Thank you once again for watching this video. We will meet in yet another video. Until then, bye-bye.